Next on Enviro Close-Up, fairness and accuracy in reporting. Fair, the Media Watch Group. Welcome to Enviro Close-Up. I am Carl Grossman. Our subject, fairness and accuracy in reporting. FAIR, the leading media watch group in the United States. With us is Janine Jackson, program director of FAIR. Welcome, Janine.
Thank you.
Janine, how did FAIR get started and what is FAIR about?
FAIR is a media watch group, and our project is basically to encourage people to consume news media critically, to think about what goes into the television news, the newspaper that they're reading, and what's left out of it. FAIR was started in 1986 by Jeff Cohen. Jeff was a social justice activist, and he came to realize just how important news media were on any social justice goals that you might have. He just saw the incredible effect that news media have in shaping public opinion. And I think he also saw that news media could be engaged with activism. This was a time in which there was a lot of environmental activism, for example, but people didn't really think about media as something that you could fight back against, that you could talk back to. And Jeff's feeling in starting FAIR was that both we should call attention to the distortions and the biases and the omissions in news media, but also we should encourage people to fight back against it, both through criticizing media directly and also through encouraging what was then called alternative media. Now it might be called independent media. Now people think of it as their major media, but then it was much smaller than it is today. So that was the project, always that two-part thing, both to criticize the news media we see and to be active in trying to get better media and newer, more independent media.
How does corporate ownership impact on the media? FAIR stresses that independent media are essential to a democratic society, but it would seem there's less and less of that. What with the continued monopolization and consolidation of media?
I think it's been one of FAIR's major contributions to call attention to corporate ownership and sponsorship of our news media. The fact that the papers and the radio stations and the TV stations that we rely on for our information about the world are holdings, essentially, in the portfolios of these giant and ever larger corporations, that wasn't something that people really focused on very much. And I think seeing, tracing that influence on the content of the news is a lot of our project here. Corporate bias is not the only bias. There are other biases in journalism that have effect, but corporate bias is kind of the floor, you know, it really undergirds everything. And if you think about it, commercials, turn on your television any hour of the day and you will see overwhelmingly not programming, but commercials. If it's after 11 o'clock at night, you will definitely see more commercials than programming. You're used to reading magazines that have more ads than news stories. It's become such a fact of life that we almost don't think about it anymore. But this is all the result of a choice, of a societal choice to make news media something that is funded and brought to us by private companies. It has an effect not just in the rampant commercialism, which really you can't overestimate. You know, we now have people who are contractually obligated to drink a certain brand of soda while they are, you know, on a television show. We have whole shows that are brought to you by a particular product, for example. You really can't get away from that. But when we look specifically at news media, we find other things. First of all, we have to remember that just like any other program, a news program will not get on the air if there is no sponsor for it. So absence or silence is one of the biggest impacts of corporate ownership. It's that simple. Anything you're not seeing, it's because a corporation can't be found that wants to pay money for you to see it. So there's that. But then there are also day-to-day acts of censorship. You know, there's really no other word for it, that have to do with the influence of both corporate owners and corporate sponsors. I mean, it's a long list, but one example that I think is so vivid that I use to kind of stand for lots of them is the example of the time that Time magazine had a big feature on environmental issues. And one of the editors of Time was very forthright and actually gave a quote to a reporter saying, of course they weren't going to focus on auto pollution in their series about environmental issues because the sole sponsor for the series was Ford Motor Company. And the editor said, you know, you don't run stories about airline crashes next to your ads for airplane companies. So in other words, there was a recognition on Time Magazine's part that pollution was a major environmental issue, that journalistically it should be part of what they were talking about, but they weren't going to talk about it because of the sponsor, because the sponsor was a car company. That sort of thing goes on every day, day after day. And at a certain point as a journalist, you don't even need to be told anymore, you know, that we're not going to do a story that makes a sponsor look bad, that we're certainly not going to do a story that makes our owner look bad or another company that's also owned by the group that owns us. You don't have to be told that as a journalist because you just know it. You see what happens to journalists who do step on those toes, who do cross those lines, and often it's up to and including their being fired. So it creates a climate in which favorable coverage to corporations and staying away from negative coverage of corporations is just understood.
Indeed, a major mission of FAIR is exposing neglected news stories. How widespread is that?
Well, of course, it's difficult to say how much news is not covered, but I think it's safe to say that it's a tremendous amount and that these are stories that we need to know. There are patterns of exclusion in news media. There's the corporate bias that I've talked about. There are whole kind of arenas of life that mainstream journalists don't delve into, and those stories go missing. I would also say, though, that it is not just that there are whole stories, there are whole people that are not in the news. It's really excluded perspectives from stories that are being covered. So, for example, you can't say media don't talk about healthcare. You know, they talk about healthcare and healthcare policy all the time. You can, however, say that even though majorities of the population are interested in a single payer system, you know, or the Canadian style, whatever you want to call it, media don't talk about that. Those people who represent those perspectives, who are for single payer, and this is just one example, don't get into those stories. So you can't say the story isn't covered, but you can say that a perspective isn't covered. Another example is when reporters talk about the economy. Gosh knows, we see plenty of economic news. It's not that it's not covered, but take an issue like the impact of the recession on African American families, for example, which has been uniquely devastating. That story is not being told. So I think on almost every issue that media do cover, you can find some piece of it, some perspective, some voice that is still being omitted, even if the story is being covered. And that's alongside all of the stories that are not getting the light of day at all. And some of those have to do with corporate malfeasance. You know, some of them have to do with looking at the downside of corporate America. You know, the fact that it's corporations that are bringing us the news, of course, is going to affect the amount of coverage we're going to see that seriously and is in a sustained way examines the negative impacts of corporate behavior.
FAIR regularly puts the spotlight on underreported environmental and energy issues. The Fukushima situation would sure seemed to be a huge example of that, and horrific and indeed still ongoing nuclear disaster, yet you don't see, hear, or read much these days in the mainstream media about what's going on and the impacts of Fukushima.
I think the story of the Fukushima disaster is really a clear example of corporate media, elite media's failure to continue to cover really anything. Their flash in the pan approach, where a story is a story for a day, but somehow to continue that story next week is not something that gets done. These kinds of stories require sustained day-to-day coverage. So there's that. There's the kind of constant looking for the newness. What's new on Fukushima? It was a disaster. It was terrible. We did that. You know, what's the story now? That's a kind of business as usual bias that media have. But I think it's also, Fukushima, I think, is also such a terrible story and involves so many bad choices, violence to human beings, poor safety records, poor regulation, all kinds of things that media are just not interested to talk about in any ongoing way. I mean, to put it very simply, you're not going to find corporate media ever really in the business of explaining how corporations are killing us. It's not what they do. And I think this is an example of where a story is just too big and too bad, you know, pulling on that string to talk about how this could have happened, what its effects might actually be, would unravel a tremendous amount. And as I know, Carl, the nuclear industry and the energy industry is a prime supporter, a prime sponsor of news media in this country. So those industry folks have reporters' ear every day, and they're telling them that nuclear power is safe. Fukushima was one terrible thing, but it doesn't necessarily mean anything overarching about nuclear power. They get those friendly messages and reassuring messages from industry all the time. And my gosh, what an easier story to tell your readers. Something bad happened, but we're all okay. The system works, and everything's going to be fine. That's the kind of story that your editor likes to see. The story of, you know, actually, I've talked to some scientists, and they say that those reassurances were not based on much, and we need to re-examine this. That's not going to move you ahead, and it's frankly just not the kind of thing the paper wants to have. But I think Fukushima also illustrates something else, which is the economics of media, where you have reporters who may not be experts in the issue that they're covering. The same guy who's writing about Fukushima this week might be writing about tax policy next week, you know, and might be writing about labor relations after that. You have reporters who are not necessarily schooled in these issues. And media outlets haven't made the commitment to invest in, for example, good science reporting. We've seen science departments, we've seen all kinds of areas of the newspaper shrinking over time. Foreign reporting has really been set back, with journalists being pulled out of countries who have expertise in those countries, and now everything's being done from New York or from Washington. So in some ways, journalists are not themselves well-versed enough to be able to read the data, and they therefore rely on government and on industry sources who are going to tend to be reassuring. And they don't have a wide enough Rolodex of scientists who can give them a view that is going to counter that view that they're getting from the government and from industry.
FAIR is very concerned about official agendas. On your website, you declare that despite the claim that the press has an adversarial relationship with government, in truth, U.S. media generally follow Washington's official line.
The relationship, the close relationship between government and news media is another primary focus of ours at FAIR. I talk a lot about corporate bias, but the truth is there's also a kind of institutional bias that elite journalists tend to have, which is that they very simply define news as what powerful people say and do. So that means that whatever a story is, the journalist's kind of credo is to get the highest ranking person to comment on that story that you can get access to. It doesn't matter if the person is going to say anything particularly revelatory. It's just you want, if you can get the president, you get the president, you know. And that is just a kind of top-down bias that elite reporters tend to exhibit. And that works out very well for government officials who always get the lead of a story, who always get to comment back to critics, and are generally given a kind of favorable approach from journalists. That's not to say that there aren't occasionally stories about politicians' wrongdoing. Of course, that does happen. But in general, politicians and government officials get a real easy pass in elite media. They get favors like, for example, anonymity, the ability to go to the paper or float any kind of comment and not attach a name to it. Well, of course, one of the real reasons that citizens rely on the press is to hold politicians accountable. So having this cozy relationship where you can call up a reporter and say anything you want and not actually put your name to it is incredibly anti-democratic. And it's also anti-journalistic. I mean, if you think about it, say there is a killing in Afghanistan and you have a Defense Department official who says everyone who was killed were Taliban, you know, or were insurgents. 2 days later, it comes out that actually civilians were killed. Why do you then, as a journalist, go back to that same Defense Department official and ask them about anything? You know, I mean, it sort of would be common sense that once sources have lied to you, once they've misled you, you would not go back to them. And yet we see the same government sources relied on again and again and again, even when, as is the case in Defense Department walkbacks on civilian deaths, they've changed their story several times. That's just a favor that journalists give to elite sources. And you know, people ask me why that is, and the argument is often that they have to do these soft stories on politicians, and do things like grant them anonymity to get access, that's what's required to get access. Well, I think that's true to a certain extent. Obviously, politicians only want to talk to reporters who they know are going to be friendly to them. But that's also a game that journalists could stop anytime they decided to stop playing. You know, they could simply say, if you won't be on the record, we won't take this comment from you. Or, you know, if you say you're going to refuse to talk to me after I write a critical story, well, I'm going to tell my readers that too and let them draw their own conclusions. We don't so much see that. And I think it's not just that you have to play that game in order to get access. I think many reporters, Beltway reporters, actually do see themselves as partners with politicians in playing a kind of gatekeeping role. They don't mind that the public's outside of that. You know, they see that as part of their job. And you have to also remember that media rely on government to get the favorable policy. You know, they are, as we recall, businesses. And they are businesses with lobbies, and they are businesses that want to do things that require regulation or an absence of regulation. So they also need those campaign ad dollars that politicians bring them all the time. That's a sizable source of income for media outlets. So there are a number of structural reasons that breed a closeness between journalists and the government officials that we, as the public, rely on them to be scrutinizing fearlessly.
Telecom policy has been a major concern for FAIR. FAIR notes that freedom of the press was guaranteed in the Constitution, but today government policy is designed less to facilitate a democratic discussion than protect the investment of media corporations. Elaborate on that if you would, Janine.
Well, I think that the telecom policy that we see around us today in 2012 has everything to do with the influence of corporate media outlets as corporations. It's really not that different than any other industry in which you see the regulators essentially captured by the industry that they're meant to be regulating. It's perhaps more serious in some ways when you talk about media because the laws and the policies can be quite vague. You know, the idea that a broadcast licensee needs to serve the public interest, well, that's the kind of policy that really needs to be given life, you know, by regulators. They need to actually be clear on what that means, you know, and if you have regulators that essentially wait for industry to tell them what they'd like to do, which is the way our Federal Communications Commission, that's meant to be representing the public interest, tends to work, it's just responsive to industry, then you're not getting that invigorated First Amendment, you know, that invigorated policy that really does encourage what they say they want to encourage, which is diverse media ownership, competition among media outlets. That's, you know, what on paper is supposed to be happening. You only need to look around to see that that's not happening. Most people have only a single cable company. You don't get to pick another cable company, you know, and this is all from an industry that's supposed to be all about competitiveness, you know. Most people have just one daily paper in their town, if that. You know, many people have a daily paper that comes from the nearest big town. It doesn't even really reflect their local community. This is all a result of policies and of the absence of policy, essentially. We have a situation where media, which could be, you really could turn on your television, the channels are there, you know. You really could have a vital, diverse, energized, multifaceted, you know, you could see anything you wanted on television. There's no technical reason why not. The reason has to do with the high barriers to entry in the field that are supported by policy. It's very expensive to get on television, and it's very expensive to run a full-scale radio station. You know, I mean, there are smaller ones, and that's great, but we've made media something that really is just the purview of a handful of companies, and that all comes back to policy, because that all could be changed. We did have public interest rules, for example, that said that the same company could not own a newspaper and a radio station and a television station all in one market. Those sorts of regulations were put there to support the public's need for diverse news media. There was a recognition that information is not a widget. It should not be treated as a commodity. We have to have different rules that govern it. Those public interest regulations have, in the last 20 years, just eroded and eroded and eroded to the point where I think many people probably don't know they exist. So telecom policy is something that can be difficult for people to get excited about, but it is something that we have to keep our eyes on, because it's made in advance of media creation. So for example, you like your free internet now. You like your ability to look at whatever website you want and have them all download at the same speed and get access as easily to foreign press as to US press. All of that could change if the government and the regulators determine that they don't want to support net neutrality rules, if they decide that they want to make it possible for some companies to pay more money and therefore have their website download at a faster speed. That could change everything about the internet. But you might not be thinking about that today, but policymakers are. So we have to get involved in those decisions that are being made in Washington, D.C., some of which seem very dry and very technical, because they are what wind up, you know, that's what results in my turning on my television and seeing more commercials than anything else.
What about diversity in the media?
Well, news media have, in the United States, unfortunately, have traditionally been not very diverse in terms of either gender or race and ethnicity. And I'm talking not so much about the newscasters that you might see. Television actually does a fairly good job of putting on television what looks like a mixed or diverse group. It's behind the scenes. It's the decision makers. Who's in the newsroom? And those positions, unfortunately, for as long as they've been tracked, have historically been overwhelmingly white and male. What that means, well, it means the same thing it means in any industry, in the sense that it's discrimination, and it hampers the ability of any industry to reflect the diversity of the country and to do whatever it's doing well and properly. In news media, of course, it has an extra effect, which is that it shapes the way we see the world. It shapes who we think is a powerful person, who is a legitimate source when we don't see certain kinds of people on television. And we don't see them in news stories, often as a direct result of those people not being in decision-making roles in the newsroom. I think any journalist of color will tell you, for example, that they have often been the one responsible for getting stories about people of color into their outlet. It shouldn't have to be their responsibility, but that is how it goes. So the lack of ethnic diversity and gender diversity in news media has an effect that is multiplied beyond the industry itself. Unfortunately, what we're seeing right now is an actual loss of people of color, for example, from traditional journalistic outlets. The numbers are actually going down, which is, you know, the numbers were low to begin with, and to decrease is really indicative of a problem. Now, there are new outlets. There are new outlets that are starting up and on the internet, and we can talk about that. But the truth is, those perspectives are being lost, and elite media is getting a more and more narrow view of the world instead of a wider and wider, even as the country itself becomes more diverse, and even as, I think, racial attitudes among the public are shifting in a positive way, we still find that absence of people of color and of their stories, of women and of their stories from the news media.
Please tell us about the various activities of FAIR: Extra Magazine, Counterspin, the radio program that you host, the FAIR blog, and how people can join up with and support FAIR.
I'm happy to talk about FAIR. FAIR, we do a lot with a little. We're just a staff of 7 people, but with that group, we publish a monthly magazine that's called Extra, where we talk about media criticism and analysis and also undercovered stories. And we also put a spotlight on good journalism as well. And we have the weekly radio show Counterspin, which it's been my pleasure to produce and host for many years now. Counterspin airs on about 150 stations around the country, and you can also get it on our website, which is fair.org. And the website is a great place to find all of FAIR. You know, we've been around since 1986. That's a lot of archived material. If there's an issue, we've probably written about it. And FAIR.org is the place to find all of those years of material. And also, we have an Action Alert Network, where we give people information about particular examples of bad media, generally, and encourage them to communicate directly with the outlet. And that often gets responses from outlets as big as the New York Times, and it also empowers people and gets them talking back to the media. So I hope that anyone who is interested in media or media criticism and wants to do something about it would check out FAIR.org and get involved in the work that we do. And of course, don't believe everything you read.
Thanks, Janine Jackson of FAIR, for your tremendous work. And thank you for watching. I'm Carl Grossman. To view this or any Enviro Close-Up, just go to our website, www.envirovideo.com.